Father God, we just bask in your presence.
Yes.
Lord, thank you for being atmosphere changer. For a peace maker. Thank you for giving us courage and not fear. Thank you for bringing us under one head, and that is Jesus. Lord, I just pray as we continue this day that we would continue to seek you. That as the atmosphere changes in your presence, Father, that we breathe in and out the Holy Spirit. Father, that we walk in that power, Father. Not on our own. Father, I pray that you remove all the human aspects of the rest of today and you just come in and show up supernaturally, Father. Lord, and we're going to thank you in advance. But Father, we're also not going to take any credit because you're the only one that is due that kind of glory. And Father, we're not going to be thieves, Father. You know, I think sometimes, Lord, we come in here and we take your glory and we're making your house into a den of thieves, Father. Lord, help us not to steal your glory, but help us to give you more and more glory for everything that you do in our lives, Father.
Do all of them, but the perfect.
We just thank you for that, and we're going to give you all the praise
number
in
six.
Jesus' name.
Don't turn that one on, but
we all said, amen. Children, I believe you got children's church today. Look at that, Mary. You didn't have to remind me. I know. Must be the 12th cup of coffee I've had today. I'm sure that's going to. Okay, not 12, maybe 11.
Are you? I think my wife just.
All right. For those of you who are older children that are staying in with us.
Yes.
There you go. There you go. I'd be one of them. Grab your Bible. If you don't have a Bible, don't grab your phone. Remember, I'm not using those. I'm going to say this every Sunday, so whatever. But I got Bibles and notebooks and pens up here. We're not even putting the words up on the screen, so you can't even rely on that, okay? Hey, isn't that great? We have words for the music this week. That was kind of nice, wasn't it? Yeah, that was good. Okay, God fixed that. We are just going to continue working through the book of Ephesians. So if you'll turn to Ephesians chapter 4. Now, last week I went through a whole chapter. And, we got through a whole chapter, believe it or not. But that's, from here on out, we're going to be taking small chunks, okay? So I want you to be in Ephesians 4. But I also want you to go ahead and start looking for Galatians 5, verse 22. And I want you to put your fingers in there. Because we're gonna do some switching back and forth, probably. See how the Lord leads here. But let's just read this together. I want to read verses 1 through 10, and that's where we are going to stop today. It's in verse 10. But it says in 4, 1, therefore, I, the prisoner of the Lord, urge you to walk worthy of a calling that you have received, with all humility and gentleness, with patience, accepting one another in love, diligently keeping the unity of the Spirit, with the bond of peace that binds us. There is one body and one Spirit, just as you were called to one hope at your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and the Father of all, who is above all and through all and in all. Now grace was given to each one of us according to the measure of the Messiah's gift, for it says, when he ascended on high, he took prisoners into captivity, and he gave gifts to people. But what does he ascended mean except that he descended to the lower parts of the earth? The one who descended is like the one who ascends far above all the heavens that he might fill all things. So in our Bibles, you know, we've got these definitions on our different paragraphs. And you know, like this one in my Bible says, unity and diversity in the body of Christ. Which, yes, it does talk about that, but I wish we didn't have those in there. Because the problem is with these things, as I said before, is we take these as sections, and we take these as that's one word, and then this section over here is another word, instead of taking it as the whole meta-narrative or the larger story of what the writer is trying to get at. And so this is kind of where we're at. Now, he starts off by saying, therefore, which, as you've been with me long enough, you know, when you see the word therefore, you need to see what it's there for. And it was talking about what we talked about last week. When we look at what we talked about last week, I just want to read you the last part of 3. And it says, now him who is able to do above and beyond all that we ask or think, according to the power of his works, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus to all generations forever and ever. Amen. Therefore, God is doing far above what we can imagine or dream or think. How many believe that? That's what God's business is. He is to do things that blows our mind. You know, it's so funny because I've seen a lot of cool things that man has done, right? I mean, man, we have made awesome technology. We have made amazing cars. We have made huge buildings. We have done marvelous artwork. We have done all these things, and I'm amazed at what God does through man. We can create so much faith. But you know what? There is something that we cannot do. There is something that blows my mind even more, and it's when I look into what he has created as far as nature that blows my mind. I know the other night, did you see the sunset? Yeah, man cannot do that. Now, we can paint it. We can take a picture of it. You know, I remember being on the east coast of North Carolina, we're looking out over the estuaries, and it was just beautiful. It was at night, and you could make out faint colors because it was dark to start, but it was a full moon. And on that full moon, there was this reflection of light that was just amazing. I mean, like, you're sitting there going, wow. And then she goes, like, you know what? I'm going to capture this, man. I don't want to ever forget this. So, man, we got out our phones and our cameras, and we're out there. Do you know I could not get that same reflection on anything that was made by man? Because God is the one who does things above and beyond what we can imagine or think or dream. And I know for a lot of us in this room, we have a lot of things in our mind that we think about and we dream about and we hope about. You see, so tonight, and I'm going to get into this, Charles probably thought I forgot, but I didn't. Tonight we're having a sacred assembly. And the reason I'm bringing this up now, and whatever, is because there may be some misunderstanding of what this thing's about. I don't know. But one of the things is that in my mind, because we serve this God that does more than we think, imagine, or dream, and it's possible. See, tonight, that's what this whole thing is about. Because we're not coming to meet because of the political thing we're at. That's not why we're meeting. Okay? We're not calling the sacred assembly to pray over this nation per se. What we're here to do is to ask God to do something that is beyond what we know and feel and think and dream of. Because in order for us to fix anything on this planet, it's going to take him and him alone. But the people have to come together. And the people have to come together in one thought, in one mind. And see, the problem is, and I'm going to tell you this, we stand on a problem. The problem is not who's in office. The problem is not clowns. The problem is not, I mean, clowns are a problem for me, but not in the big picture of things. The problem is not what we have in our driveway or what we live in. The problem is not our tax breaks, our health, our insurance, our health things. Those aren't the problems. The problem is that his body, his church, the people that are supposed to be represented by the cross of Jesus are divided. We are not in one accord. So, yeah, maybe I'm using the political realm a little bit to show this. Maybe that's what God's trying to do. But see, we're not just divided in the body, but we're divided as a nation. We're divided as a world. There's more racism today than there ever has been on the planet. There is more human trafficking. There are more bondage, people in slavery and chains to things that has ever been possible on this planet. But we are so thick-headed that we think, oh, back then was worse. No, we haven't gotten better, folks. You know why? Because we are divided and we're looking to something that will not fix it. There's one person, one thing that is going to make it, and that is, first of all, if His people who are called by His name will humble themselves and pray and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and I will heal their land. So it starts here, in the body. So when we come together tonight, oh, you need to pray for me. Because what I'm trying to do is take this from the Old Testament, okay? Sacred assemblies will call it the Old Testament. Now, I get it. We're the New Testament church. I get it. But we're not. Jesus said, I came to fulfill all things. That doesn't mean that He's finished with it. Now, He did say He is finished. It is finished. But He was talking about the separation factor. That He made a way that we do not have to be separated. In other words, He made that gap between those things so that we can cross and come together, be whole, and do what we're supposed to do. But in the time of Nehemiah, he called sacred assemblies. I know, I'll get to this, I promise. We're all going there. But he called sacred assemblies. And in Nehemiah, he called them, why? Because, listen to this, the church was in, the people of God were away from their home. They were in other areas. They were because of their sin, God judged them, found them wanting, and they were taken over, and they were taken into captivity, and they were taken away from their home. You see, in the Old Testament, you got to understand the land of Israel is, that was their inheritance. That was what they were. That is precious in God's sight. It still is. But here's the thing. They were gone so far away that Nehemiah, who God gave courage and said, we're going to come back and they're going to start building a wall. Now, we think wall as in far as protection or whatever, but I'm going to tell you that I believe the wall that Nehemiah built was not a protection thing. It was a separation thing. It was a sanctification thing. It was to say that this is God's place. Well, let's look at this for today. Because see, today I think there's a lot of people in the church who have been far away from God in their heart because of issues and things. And we have fallen into idol worship, either of self or of politics or whatever, okay? Or of things. And now all of a sudden, God is calling us back home. And what they would do when they got to this, Nehemiah had the people gather and they built this platform. And on this platform, he opened up the Torah, which is the first five books of the Bible, right? Okay, first five books of the Bible. And he read them all. Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy. You want to talk about church service? I know I preach a long time, but come on. All right? Now, but if you break that down, what he was reading was the law. The law is found in the first three books of the Bible, Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus. The other things are historical things. The law is given in these books. Jesus came, our rabbi, right? Our rabbi said this. First, public ministry display, what did he do? He went up on the mount and he began to preach. Matthew 5, 6, and 7, notice the three chapters, was about how it looks to live out the Torah. So he goes, we're not going to go through all the dots and all the T's and all these things, but Jesus says, I'm going to teach you what it looks like to live it out. So tonight we're going to come together and we're going to read the Sermon on the Mount. Three chapters, not five books. The reason I'm talking about this is because the whole point of what Nehemiah was trying to do was bring the people together under one banner, and that is Jesus. Amen. Nehemiah was trying to, and I said, wait a minute, that's Old Testament. Yes, but you have to understand, he was already looking forward to the one to fulfill the Torah. And so he brought them together, and now all of a sudden, they came together. And when they came together, do you know what happened? They built the wall. They built it. They had enemies attacking. They said that the people joined together. One had a hand on a sword, and the other did the work. They were watchful, but they did it. And I don't know about you, but it's time. And I'm not talking about separating this land as God's land, because I believe there's only one God's land, and that's Israel, physically. But spiritually, we individually make up the land of God. We are His kingdom. He lives within us. And we need to sanctify. We need to come together, and we need to do some spiritual battle. We need to have the hand. Oh, you ready for this? We need to have one hand on our sword, the Word of God, and one hand doing His work. But we cannot do that. We cannot do that unless we come together in one sacred assembly. And I want you to know, you know what happens after a sacred assembly? Read it, study it out. Revival. Now see, I believe we're in the crux of revival right now. There's a sprinkling coming. You know, like a rainstorm? Starts out kind of sprinkling, gentle rain. But at some point, when the church is ready, it is going to be a full-out gully washer of the Holy Spirit on His people, and there is going to be a revival across this land. We're watching. It's so funny because people send me things, hey, did you know so-and-so was talking about this, or did you know so-and-so was talking about this, or this big preacher's preaching this and doing that. God is calling His people together. Man, the same message is going forth all over this nation. Thing is, are we going to be a willing participant? How does this look like for us? Therefore, first of all, Paul in this scripture is saying, therefore, I, the prisoner of the Lord Jesus Christ. Remember, volunteer prisoner he was. I've had a hard week. And, you know, our family's been sick. I don't know if you know, but this stomach thing is going around. I don't wish that on anybody. It's not good. And just some other things that are happening. And I looked at my wife today and I said, you know, Paul had it right. Get thrown in prison and write letters. Peaceful. I mean, it's like, I sit here and I can write letters and send it out. And then I can write another one and send it out over here. Oh, wow, he had it right. He was willing to do what it took. So he's a prisoner. He says, I'm the prisoner of the Lord Jesus Christ. And it says that I urge you. This is funny to me, because who listens to a prisoner? Paul's argument to listen to him is that he's a prisoner. You want to talk about a kingdom upside down? Because normally, we don't listen to. But he says, look, I volunteered to be in this prison for you. I volunteered to give this up. Matter of fact, at one point in his ministry, he says, man, I wish I could give up my salvation for you. Oh, man, what if the whole church felt like that about lost people? What would happen? And he says, look, I'm a prisoner. I'm here. He goes, I urge you to do something for me. He says, I want you to walk worthy of the calling that you have received. Walk, to travel, to go about one's lifestyle. That's what it means. He goes, I want you to walk in this, to live this way. It doesn't mean just as a journey. See, when we think walk, we think about the destination. But where am I walking to? Paul says, no. You've already been given the destination. You've been given a calling. So what I want you to do is live your life every day according to this calling. Well, what's our calling? Well, we can take this 20 different ways. You can talk about your calling that God has given you, your vocation, your career, right? Is that what Paul's talking about? Absolutely not. What is he calling about? He's talking about what we've been talking about, the one new man. He's been talking about bringing the non-followers into the realm of follower. He's talking about becoming one new man. He says, that's your calling. Do you know we have no other calling but that? Now, the way we go about that's different, right? Some people have a career, and I hate these words. I hate using these words, secular and sacred or whatever. I hate them. Because sometimes God calls us to work outside the church, amen? Actually, that's probably about 99% of us. We work outside the church, not in the ministry realm, right? He's called us, and that's been our career, but guess what? That's just the way, that's just the way we're supposed to walk to live out our calling. Does that make sense? So if God calls me to be a teacher, I am to teach as if I'm teaching unto God, and I am to walk it out, this path. So the path that he's giving me is teaching, but really I'm on the journey of my calling, which is bringing those who don't follow God into those who follow God. Does that make sense? All right. So, my question for us today is, are we walking worthy of that call? Because I've just found out, well not just found out, but I've been learning over my lifetime that your calling is just the same as my calling. And we're going to get in next week into a subject called the fivefold ministry that has been decimated by the church because we've been doing it wrong. But we're going to talk about that because he's getting ready to give us, this is how you walk it out. Did you know that was a word? That's amazing to me. So, how does this look? Last vacation, my family got to go on a tour of a battleship from World War II. North Carolina. USS North Carolina. And we got to tour this thing, and we actually got to go on the, it was just a random day we went, right? It was like, hey, we're going here, but we're going to stop by at the place. See what they got going on. Well, that day happened to be one of the 3 days that they do this a year, where they have all the volunteers come on, and there's people in every main station who is explaining and demonstrating and showing us everything. So, like, when we went on the bridge, there was a captain. Former admiral of the Navy was there explaining how things worked. How cool is that? Right? Now, some of you aren't history. I'm a World War II nut, okay? So, because I believe that that's a crux, and it's found in Scripture. It's just very interesting, but I digress. So, I'm there, and we're watching these things, and we're going through this, and we come to this one panel, which is how they kind of make this shit go. And it's this huge panel. I mean, it's big. And there's all these knobs and things. No computers, okay, because it's all like steam-driven or turbine-driven stuff, right? And there's all these knobs and levers. I mean, you had to have, I was sitting there going, it's worse than an airplane cockpit. You know, you look at new airplanes today, the big jets, and you look and they have all these instrument, whatever, and they got all these knobs, but the pilot never touches it because it's all done by computer. They may take off, and then they go, it's up to you. That scares me. Anyway, so that's how it was with this man. This was like, man, you had to crank things and you had to do this and whatever. But the thing that I saw that stood out to me was this panel of gauges. I mean, every kind of pressure gauge known to man. And I was like, wow, and you got to thinking about this, and you realize something that, man, those were the instrumentations in which they used to see if they had trouble or not. It was the area in which they said, oh, this is not working correctly. We need to adjust this crank, flip this lever, thing, kick this door in, hold my tongue to the left, and hopefully that'll make this gauge go down, right? So this is how this thing's working, and I was like, wow. Then I got to thinking about cars. It used to be you had gauges on cars, right? Now we have what we call idiot lights. Not saying anything if you like idiot lights. I'm just saying. But it used to be that we had a gauge that gave us where we were headed and what we were doing. And now all of a sudden we have this light going beep, 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 and you don't know what it's doing. So I was thinking about this. And I go, okay. Well, he says walk worthy of a calling. I go, I wonder. If God is a God of any lights or God of gauges. I know that's a stretch, but I'm just saying, could he be a God of both? Yes. Because some of us need idiot lights. Some of us just wants to know when it's broke. Others wants to know when we're breaking. But I think he's really a God of gauges. He shows us what we're doing. Well, God, what are those gauges? So I'm sitting here studying Ephesians 4, and he's talking this prisoner of God, this bond slave, this guy who voluntarily chained himself to the cross of Christ. He urged me to walk worthy of this calling, which we've talked about. Oh, and by the way, he can do it in your life. Because remember, he's the guy who is able to do above and beyond all we ask and think, according to what says it right here, right? So it says, well, how do I know? He says, well, when you're walking this call, if you're worthy, you're walking in all humility. You see, humility, gentleness, patience, accepting one another, love, dignity, or diligently keeping the unity of the Spirit with the bonds that bind us. I started reading those things and I went, that sounds like another verse that I know. And so if you would, I'd like you to turn to Galatians. I told you we'd get there. 5. And in Galatians 5, he gives us a set of gauges. Two different kinds of gauges. He gives us what the gauges of the flesh are, and then he gives us what the gauges of the Spirit is. And we can go through the gauges of the flesh if you want. You know, it's idolatry, sorcery, hatred, strife, jealousy, outbursts of anger, selfish ambition, dissensions, factions, envy, drunkenness, carousing, and anything similar. But then he says, but the gauges of the Spirit are, and it looks like this, is love. And then it says joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faith, some says faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against this thing, there is no such law. So I'm looking at these and I go, okay, these are gauges. But how has the church looked at these? We have looked at these things, now you need to hear me, as idiot lights. In other words, when I get it, I will have the light on. You ever read that? Patience, gentleness, goodness, all those things. If you think you're going to achieve all those things before like Jesus is on the throne, and man, I need to spend some more time with you. Because man, there's a fight. There's a flesh and spirit fight. And so I started looking at these things and said, you know what? I've been looking at these wrong. Humility is not something that I just get. It is a gauge to show me how I'm walking worthy of the calling that he's given to me. If we want to be worthy of this calling of the one new man, then guess what? I had better be humble. If you want to know what humble means, I'll give it to you in the Greek, and then I'm going to spell it for you. Because my wife asked me to. Tapheinophrosune. Let me say that again. Tapheinophrosune. And it is spelled T-A-P-E-I-N-O-P-H-R-O-S-Y-N-E with a line over the top of the E. That's important. Are you happy? You're welcome. I'm only doing one. That's that one. Okay. All right. We're good now. It means a disposition of valuing or assessing oneself properly, especially in light of one's sinfulness and creatureness. In other words, humility is how I see myself, how I assess myself, but not based on how good I am, but based on where God has brought me from. So depending on where, you know, based on my sinfulness, so is God moving me from one area to the other? I mean, is he growing me? Is he changing me? Is he making, or my creatureness? I love that because at first I thought I misread my fellow creativeness, so that doesn't make sense, but it's creatureness. In other words, that flesh, natural man. It's basically saying flesh versus spirit. So how do we assess you? I'm going to tell you what. Church, if we walk around like we're better than everybody else, who's going to listen to us? ourselves on how good we are, we got a problem. Because the Bible says in the scripture that we ain't not good. There is no one without sin. No, not one. So, I mean, we got to be humble. So humble is not something I get. Humble, humility is something I achieve and something I work for. It's a gauge to show me how I'm walking in the Spirit. Well, what's another one? Gentleness. Gentleness. How I act, and humility and gentleness all go hand in hand. Also, with that, with humility and gentleness, they come from the same Greek root word, which is awesome, is also self-control. Because if you've got self-control, you're probably going to be humble and you're going to be gentle. So all these things that we're talking about, he's saying, this is your gauge. We all have in our lives examples of people who have not been gentle to us. Now, sometimes I believe that we don't need gentleness. We need a good, swift kick in the rear. That's when God brings out his holy 2x4. Now, he's the only one that has one. See, I think the church needs to understand, we think we have the right to carry one, and we don't. God's the only one that carries one, and he can smack me upside the head anytime he wants. That's his priority. That's his thing. But sometimes, in the body of Christ, we need gentleness. Then it says, with patience. There's a saying, don't ever pray for patience. And I'm going to tell you right now, that is why the church is in the mess, right? Because we are fearful of praying for one thing that we need most. Now, I understand. I am a father and a teenager. And your patience can only go so far. But my God is able to do above and beyond what I can think, dream, or imagine. But at the same time, there are consequences for actions. I guess what I want you to see is that gauges are used to balance things. Isn't that true? And so, a lot of times what we want to do is we want to go full force in all these things, but God's like, no, I need you to be balanced. In this situation, you need some gentleness. In this situation, you need some patience. All of them, you probably need a little self-control, but it's a balance. I find it interesting that most gauges that you have, where you want it is in the middle. It's a balance. And so there are some times that we have, listen, there are some times that there are actions and they have consequences for those actions. And guess what? God loves us enough that he does not remove consequences. Because if he removes the consequences, we don't learn anything. There's a statistic that we tell in the Conqueror series and Battle Brothers, that life is made of 2% circumstances and the rest is consequences. Yes, you may find yourself in a circumstance, but with that circumstance, where you're really going to live is with the consequences later on. And so we have consequences. So sometimes our gauges, if we don't pay attention to our gauges, there are consequences. And sometimes those consequences hurt others, and sometimes they hurt yourself. But here's the thing. We can get stuck there and say, woe is me, or woe is them. And we can get stuck there and never move and never start walking worthy of the calling that we've been called to. At some point, we have to say, okay, Lord, that's my consequence. That's our consequence. And now I'm going to walk worthy of what you're calling me to do, which is bring unity and peace. So now we walk in these things, and we learn, and we do this. And it's hard. The next thing he says is accepting one another in love. Some of your versions say to bear one another, which means to lift one another up. I need to speak to you from a pastor's heart that says the pastor or the elders, which is our keepers, or the Sunday school teachers, do you realize that our arms get tired of holding people up? And sometimes we need people to come and lift our arms. Or sometimes we need people just to come over and take over. To accept one another, I think sometimes we read that for just a second and we go, oh, we're to accept one another, and we have the human understanding of what acceptance means. That means we accept them, and, you know, no matter what, which is true. We want to love them, people where they're at. But I like the version where it says to bear one another up, to lift one another up, because sometimes lifting the people up to Jesus is really showing them the consequence. Sometimes bearing doesn't look like, I'm going to tell you what, do I believe that the church needs to accept people where they are, even if they're sinners? Yes! Especially when they're sinners. I'm going to tell you what, man, we love, we accept, but I'm going to tell you what, if you call yourself to me a follower of Jesus and you act like a sinner, you are going to hear from me. Because now I'm going to hold you to a higher standard because you are boldly saying, I'm a follower of God. Now that doesn't mean that we can't make mistakes. Accepting one another in what? Love. Boy. There you go. Agape, by the way, is the Greek word for that. We all know what that means. That I like to change the meaning of words because agape, I learned it as unconditional love. But agape really is a conditional, unconditional love. Because the deeper I love Jesus and the more I follow him, then the bigger conditions he gives me in our relationship. Make sense? So if I'm walking with Jesus a long time, guess what? He expects me to walk worthy of the call. He expects my eyes to be on the gauges that he's given me. He expects me to get my eyes off of other people's gauges and take a look at my own. Now, then it says, diligently keeping the unity of the Spirit. Zealous, zeal, diligently. This is weird, this comes to my mind, but the ant. Boy, it sounds like a little bit of Proverbs, doesn't it? Where the ant works diligently at what he does. If you easily get your toes stepped on, you might want to put your feet under your chair. Because I think sometimes what we need to do is we need to look at the balance of what we're working diligently at. I'm here to say that probably most of the time we work diligently at everything else except the thing that we are called to do. What is the unity of the Spirit? What does that mean? What does that look like? Flesh versus Spirit. Flesh brings division. Spirit brings unity. If we're watching our gauges, we are going to have a unity. If we're watching everybody else's gauges, then we're already dividing ourselves. We're already saying that I am better than you are. I don't need to watch mine. I just need to watch yours because you're in trouble. I'm not. Therefore, we already have the vision, and we already have the problem. You see, the division in the church is not based on politics, race, or anything else. The division in the church is, I don't believe that we take our walk and our calling seriously. I mean, really, if Yeshua stood here today and looked at you in the eye and looked at me in the eye, I guarantee we couldn't take the gaze. And to be honest with you, grace and glory. Because also, with this keeping diligently the unity of the Spirit, I mean, that's diligently walking in the Spirit. That's diligently. That means, yeah, you know what? I love the word diligently because that means there's a fight that makes me keep an eye on what I'm supposed to do. It's funny. The statistics for accidents, do they happen farther away from home or closer away from home? Less than 5 miles home. Why? Because we get relaxed because we're almost home and we're thinking about the chair and the sofa and the TV. So we're not alert. See, what I think is happening in the Western church is the church has not been alert. It's like we've been so close to home and we just went, whatever. And now we're in a wreck. Yeah, there's some hard things. And we have to say some hard things to people. We have to do some hard things. We have to, but man, we do it in love. We do it in a keeping of this bonds of peace. Because when we walk in the Spirit, the bonds that bring us together, there is peace. And I don't know about you, but man, we are in need of peace. I'm not talking world peace, because world peace will come naturally when the individual has the peace of God in their heart. So we need to understand these are gauges. Why are these gauges so important? Because it keeps us on the right path to walk this way we're supposed to walk. And in order for us to do that, he says, watch these gauges. Why do we do this? Because he says, there is only one body. And he uses the word one. One. It is God, not God in the church. It is God. He says there is one body. He's talking about the church. He says there is one way in which Jesus intends to live out this calling. It's through one body. That means a unified body. Each part doing what it's supposed to do. It means, and let me tell you something. Next week, I hope I just trashed the way we've taught this in the church. But we all have a job to do. We all have this thing. But there are times in the body, listen to this, where there's some of us that are toes, and some of us that are shoulders and fingers, and some of us are muscles, and some of us are ligaments, and some of us are nerves. Some of us step on nerves. Some of us, you know, we all have a part to play. And so when we think about this, we think, oh, well, everybody in the world's got to be buddy-buddy. No, not really. Because I'm going to tell you what. And I've used this thing before, and it made someone laugh, and I don't mean to make you laugh, but, okay, we have a body, right? Say I'm the big toe. No, I'm not big. I'm the little toe. I'm the little toe, right? And then there's someone in the body that's the shoulder. If my little toe is up next to the shoulder, you have a problem. First of all, I've broken something, or pulled something, or if I got a little toe growing out of the shoulder, none of you would keep it there. You would go had it removed. Am I right? I mean, you got a toe on your shoulder. There ain't no shoulder pads going to cover that. Sometimes in the body, listen, sometimes in the body, we are separated. Right? In the body, there are systems. There's the nervous system. Right? And then there's the circulatory system. They're all the same body, but they do totally different things. And guess what? They all need each other. But they don't run in the same circles. And it's okay. So sometimes, see, we in the church, man, we mess things up so much. But there's one body, and by the way, we're all fueled by one Spirit. And not only are we fueled by one Spirit, our calling is to one hope. Guess what? We are bad about this. Well, we hope we get this. We hope we get this. We hope we get this. We hope this happens. We hope this. Man, elections. Man, we hope he's in. Her in. We hope none of them are in. We hope something else happens. We hope this. We hope that. And guess what? I think the God's saying, quit hoping for those things and hope for the one thing that I've given you, and that's my son Jesus. One hope. One gospel. One good news. said that you were called to that one hope that you're calling. The one hope is that we can have one new man. Do you know why that's our hope? Because there are brothers and sisters out there that the body needs that we don't have yet. Because we're too lazy to get off our chairs and be human to somebody. We're too busy watching other people's gauges that we don't get off the couch to watch our own. And here's the thing. Well, why would I, man, if I see one of my gauges, you know, I gotta do maintenance. It's so much easier to do maintenance on somebody else than it is on me. He says, so then you're called to this. We're called to the one new man. We're called to the unity. We're called to this because look, we need one body with Christ as the head. We need one body filled by one spirit because we have one hope at our calling. The one Lord, and then he goes in, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all. Then he says, who is above all, through all, and in all. And y'all, this is not a new age thing. Let me give you God is not all things. He's in all things. God is through all things. You know, I wonder if the church has really accepted that teaching. Oh, I wonder. First of all, only when things are going good do we say God is above all things. One thing goes wrong, and what do we do? What do we do? Yes! We whine, we complain, we say, where is God? Well, God's above all things! He hasn't moved. He's using your circumstance to cause a consequence in your life so you'll become more like him. He's above all things. Well, that's easy for you to say. You don't have financial problems. He's above your financial problems. Well, you don't have family problems. Oh, yeah? Focus on my family for a while and see what you got. God is above my family problems. Well, Pastor, I've got health problems. You don't even know. God is above our health problems. But what if it doesn't work out the way I want it? God's above your answer. Because let me tell you something. Your answer is based on flesh, human thinking, and it's not your fault. That's God's way God made you. But when we start walking in the Spirit, we start walking in unity with one another. We start walking this path, this road, and we start walking worthy of this. And we start watching our gauges, and we start, oh man, you know what? He's doing that in me right here so that I can have a little bit more patience. Okay, oh, I'm having this addiction. I'm having this struggle here. Maybe that's so because he wants to help me learn self-control. Oh, well maybe, man, I'm anger, and I have a short fuse. Well, maybe he's going to use that in you to cause you to be a peacemaker, not a keeper, a peacemaker in the life. Because remember, there's a difference between a peacekeeper and a peacemaker. Peacekeeper just wants to make everybody happy. They want to keep the peace. Where God hasn't called us to do that. God has called us. Parents need to listen up. Listen up, parents. Quit trying to keep the peace in your home and make the peace in your home. If you're following under God's way, you're doing the best you can to walk in the Spirit, you are not letting your flesh lead, I'm going to tell you what, you make the peace, and it's what God says. And there's a lot of things about what God says in this. See, the problem that we have today is there's a whole bunch of people who just try to be a peacekeeper. That means I just want to be my kid's best friend. Who wants that? You will have time to be the friends of your children when they are grown and they have kids and they realize how much they put you through. But until then, fathers, you are the head of your household. Act like it. I didn't make the rules. And I'm not just saying fathers. Moms, It says in Ephesians, we're going to get there, the husbands and wives, submit to one another in love. That means when a husband and wife come together, they are the head of the household. What they say goes, I don't care what reasons you have, children. But it works the same way in the church. There is authority that has been placed in the church. You may not like it. Don't talk to me about it. Talk to God. There is authority that's been placed in the church. It's found in 1 Peter. And I want, listen, 1 and 2 Peter, there is an establishment in which he said, this is how it's going to go. And that's what we deal with. 85% of the people who church hop because they do not like the authority structure based in that church. Guess what? A lot of times the church is screwed up because we're human. But if the church is doing everything they can to follow the scripture and do that, then guess what? Man, just sit in your chair, learn what God has you to do because he's teaching you something. Don't throw a fit and take the ball and go home. A lot of people come to our church because they have left the church because of hurt. And sometimes people are here for just a season. They're here to heal. Man, we don't mind being a hospital for the sick, do we? Matter of fact, the keepers, your elders, and I believe that is our calling, to be the hospital for the sick. Sometimes the sick have to get well and go back and make amends. Sometimes you find a home, you find an island of misfit toys. Keep thinking of the elephant on that cartoon for some reason. I don't know why. I don't know if that's something to do with self-esteem. I'm not sure. But anyway, I won't analyze myself. So, do you understand that God is above all these things? God wants to work through all of us. Through all things. Weather, money, jobs. See, I don't know if you really understand this, church. Because that means even when negative things happen to us, we have beyond me, but he's the one who goes beyond me, amen? And he's the one who says, man, thank me for it. Thank me for it because I'm going to do something new in your life today. Then he goes on and says, he's above all, and he's in all. That means in any circumstances, you can find something that God wants to teach you. He's in all. Then he says, now grace was given to each of us according to the measure of the Messiah's gift. Grace, remember, grace and gifts, Paul uses them in her. He says, man, it's the grace that I've been given the ability to use my gifts to those that I once persecuted. So grace was given to each of us according to the measure of the Messiah's gift. That means according to the measure of the Messiah's gift. What was the Messiah's gift? His life. His position. He came down here. He left his throne in heaven to walk in dirty feet. To hold dirty hands. To hug dirty people. He came as a light into the darkness. He came. He did that. His gift was his life. It says when he ascended on high. Now, this is found from Psalm 68, verse 18. Now, I do not have time, I realize this, to read all of Psalm 68. I get it. So your homework is to go and read Psalm 68. Can I get an amen that we're going to do that? But I'm going to give you the Reader's Digest version of Psalm 68. It is all about God's majestic power. It says no matter what happens on this earth, God is over and above and through all things. I mean, he talks about enemies coming in. He talks about accusations. He talks about all kinds of stuff. But what comes out is that God, listen to this. When he came and he came down, he says he took prisoners, and we all automatically go, I thought he came to set the prisoners free. Contradiction in Scripture. No, he came to set us free from earthly and made us to go to bond slaves. Voluntarily going, I will lay down my life for my brother. In other words, I will decrease so that my brother can increase. I will do what I can. Because he says, look, he goes, you ascended on the height, taking captive, taking away captives. He goes, you know, man, he's snatching us out. How many have been snatched out by Jesus? Come on now. You know what I'm talking about. Come on, what were they snatching? More about a gentle push. No, man. For me, I was in the fires of hell because of my circumstance, and my Jesus snatched me away from that. See, we've been snatched away. We have taken those things. It is all great. And then he says, man, he's taken those prisoners. You know, Paul rephrases it in the song. He says, he takes us from a high. He takes those prisoners. He snatches them away. He makes them bond slaves. And then he gives us gifts. That's why Paul says, as a prisoner, I can ask you to urgently walk in a way worthy of the call. Why? Because, man, he's been given something. He's been given graces. He's been given gifts. He's been given things. We all have. Then in verses 9 through 10, it says that, but what does the sin mean except that he descended to the lower parts of the earth? He's talking about Jesus came down. So that one might ascend, so one who descended is also the one who ascended far above the heavens, that he might, listen, fill all things. Humanly, man, I want to keep preaching. Because I want to get to the gifts. I want to get to where God has called his people. But I want you to know that we cannot. Receive true gifts of the Spirit until we understand that he is the one who is in all, through all, and fills all things. And that means that us understanding that he lives in us, that means we have the fullness of God in us if we choose to use it. And the reason our gifts are inadequate is because we are not letting the fullness of God rest in us. So Pastor, he said, true gifts of the Spirit. Yes. But I'm going to tell you what. There is a lot. You know, it's funny because I think sometimes we take scriptures so literally. It says, beware of false prophets and teachers or whatever. Man, I wish it was said, man, beware of false gifts. Beware of the imitator. Beware of the one who's in it for the show. Beware of the one who is trying to have all righteousness on the outward but is willing, not willing to submit to the way God has set things up. I've been there. Right? And I'm just saying what we need to do is we need to be a people that understands that he wants, says that he might fill all things. He wants to fill us all. He wants to fill us to the point that we can understand the gifting that he's given us. Because every one of us has been given a gift. And no, we're not going to go through a season where we're going to do a spiritual gift test. Can I be honest with you? I hate those things. Because guess what? I believe that we've all been given the gifts of God, and when God needs us to use them, he will grant it to us. See, I don't believe we just get one gift. Now, I've done the spiritual gift test, and amazingly enough, that one of my gifts is teaching. If you look at it, it's apostleship, prophecy, teaching, shepherd. That's what man has told me my giftings are. I don't care what man tells me my giftings are. Because there's been some times in my life where God has given me a gift for a moment and only that moment, and I have used that gift for the glory of the kingdom, and I've never received that gift. And guess what? I am okay with that. I believe that he is calling an army forth. Listen to this. That is willing to be used in whatever capacity that he has called us to in the moment. I think for so long we've tried to separate us all out into, oh, that's his gifting, that's her gifting. Yeah, there are certain things that people are better at than I am, right? But when I need it, God will give it to me. I don't know, some of you know this, and team, you can come on up. Some of you may know this, been around here long enough, one of my non-gifts, okay, one of the ones I struggle with, is just going to tell you, hospital visitations. Man, hospitals creep me out. I do not know why. I'd rather spend a day at a morgue than in a hospital. I know that sounds weird, but I don't know what it is, and I've struggled with it. And for some of you who've been in the hospital and you've seen someone else come and visit you instead of me, well, chickens. Okay, to be honest with you, I don't like hospitals almost as much as I don't like clowns and bananas. Okay, I'm just telling you.
Spiders.
And spiders and Brussels sprouts. Anyway, that's the list. But beside the point. That's not my gifting. That right there, I struggle with. But guess what I have to do sometimes? Go to a hospital. But sometimes God will send someone to go with me. Sometimes it's my wife. I love this, what happens to my wife and I sometimes. We'll go to the hospital, and I'll get in there, and I'm just praying the TV's on. And my wife comes in, and my wife, man, she sweats mercy. It just comes out of every pore that she has. I'm sorry, she glows mercy. Sorry, honey. Princesses don't sweat, they glow. Anyway, sorry, I had a little choke there. But there are times when we go or whatever, and my wife, she is just, oh. I watch her talk to people, and she holds her hand and pat her, and says the right things. And I'm like, Jess, what else is food? You know, I mean, literally, that's where I'm at. Don't know what to say, because, I mean, everybody knows why we're here. We're sick. That's why we're here, whatever. And then, so, you know, she'll talk, and I'm sitting there, you know, watching the game, or whatever. And then she goes, well, I guess we'll get going. You know, we'll just pray for you. And she kind of gets you over there, and I'll pray, and then we'll go home. And then weeks later, you know, oh, it was so nice. The pastor came and spent so much time with me. My wife who did it. Yeah. Here's the thing. She really didn't do it either. But the Holy Spirit working through. The Holy Spirit works through us differently. So I'm not trying to say that we should be good at all things, because we're not. But we should be willing to go where He calls us in the moment that He calls us to go. What does that look like tonight? And what does that look like for us as we move forward in our society? That's funny, because I was reading the passage of the scripture where Paul was, what Peter was saying, oh God, I'm going to go with you wherever. I mean, I'll go to the ends of the earth with you. Right? What did Jesus tell him? Hey, you're right. Right now, you go where you want to. But there's a time coming when you will be led where you don't want to. There'll be things that happen in your life that you have no control over. There are things that you were going to think are the worst thing possible. And you will be going there. But it's for my glory. So, how does this look? Here in the next several days, some things are going to go down in this country. And I say this, and I've been saying it, I've been trying to get it out that the church needs to quit worrying and start praising. I mean, I get it. There's pluses and minuses. I get it. But see, we could have been a Christian nation a long time ago, but we can't expect every year we have to be a Christian. Or after. So it's not about the circumstance in which we find ourselves. And I'm going to tell you what, it's even not about the consequences that we find ourselves facing. Why? Because then we got one hope. God is above all these things. So as we come back this afternoon together at 5:30, I'm going to ask you to come in the right spirit. Okay? Yeah, it's not, I'll be honest with you, it's not, I've got certain people that are praying for certain things. Okay? Yes, I have asked people to pray for certain things. And no, we are not going to open up for just anybody to pray. Okay? We're not going to do that. I don't feel led to do that. Matter of fact, I feel that this is the way God has set this thing up. The attitude I want you to go into is like, guess what? I'm going to come, and I may not be praying out loud, but I'm going to be in my chair, and God can hear me still. But the attitude that I want is not like, oh man, we're going to go in and we're going to pray for all the healing, all the things for our nation. No, what we're going to do is we're going to come in together under the banner of love of Jesus, and we are going to, as a group, say, forgive us of where we've messed up. Forgive us for where we haven't walked in the way worthy of this calling. And Lord, I know there's consequences because of this. But I'm going to praise you in the storm. I'm going to praise you in the circumstance. It doesn't matter what happens in the election. I'm going to praise you. We're not just praying for that, but we got people that are going to be praying for our children. We got people that are going to be praying for our servicemen and our firefighters and our policemen. We've got people that are going to be praying for individual things. Why? Because as Jason said, it's time for the church to come together and do what we were called to do, and that's pray down God on this nation, and in our cities, and in our families. Because I'm going to tell you what, if the nation goes to pot, but my family makes it to the throne room of God, I have been successful as a man of God. It's not about this nation. Guess what? It never was. It was about being a city on a hill. It was about being the light and the reflection of who Jesus is. It's about being the mouth and the feet and the hands of Jesus to the lost and the hurting. It's about a one new man attitude to say, I'm going to do whatever I can to bring those who don't know Jesus, who don't follow Jesus. And I love the word non-follower, because guess what? You can sit in the church every day and not be a follower of God or a follower of Jesus. I'm going to tell you what. It's time to come together in unity. I don't know about you, but I'm excited. I'm excited about this next coming year. Because no matter what happens, my Jesus, at least in this house, is going to be lifted up and glorified. And you know what? Man, I'm going to praise him. Oh, and if we lose some religious freedom on the way, praise be to God that's going to ground and do the real work of Jesus. You see what I'm saying? It's time for us to reach across whatever aisle you have put in the way. You know, we say that and we think, oh, we're talking political. No. You have put aisles between yourselves. Let's be bridges of Jesus instead of walls of division. Let's be sanctified instead of apart. Instead of being caved in.